Okay, cool. So I wanted to just paint the picture of what's going on here, because it's going to be a very interesting chat today. I'm talking to Fiel Sahir. Have I pronounced your name correctly?
Mm-hmm.
Cool. And it's I'm here in London, and you are in?
I'm at home in New York right now.
At home in New York. Mm-hmm. It is the first day of spring here in London. I've been out in the park. I just looked at myself in the mirror, and I'm a bit of a mess. I've been out in the park all day, and I just come home and cooked a big green curry. And I've just realized I've got kind of green curry splattered all over me. But I was super happy to talk to you about this topic today, because it's something that we've kind of been emailing back and forth about a little bit. And it's clear that we've got a lot in common in terms of musical background. So on this beautiful day with kind of green curry wafting through the air, I'm really pleased to kind of sit down and chat to you about this today. We're going to be talking about music and our backgrounds with music, and how that impacts on language learning. That's right, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Good, just checking I haven't got confused. So let's start by just very quickly talking about our own personal backgrounds with music. And let's start with that and then see where we go from there. So what's your, tell us a little bit, first of all, about your background with music and then about your background with languages.
Okay. Let's see which one is easier to start with. So my dad was a guitarist at some point in his life. And so that was always around the house. And being a child of immigrants, money to pay for music lessons is not exactly a priority. So my mom said, let's just take lessons with dad, and which wasn't easy, but it was a good thing in the end. And so that's how I got started with classical guitar. And somehow
is that your main instrument, classical guitar?
Yeah, classical guitar.
Okay.
Yeah. And so that's where I'm at now. I finished my undergrad at the New England Conservatory in Boston, and now I'm in Germany studying over there. But going on with languages, they sort of tie in together, because I have this love for people and different cultures just so much. And music and language are both part of the whole culture bubble, so to speak. And so when I was 13, sorry, when I was 10, I was in a car ride coming home from vacation with family friends, and we're Indonesian, and being an Asian American in the States is not very easy. You know, you get made fun of, and so I didn't want to be Asian per se.
Is that just New York, or is it everywhere?
Well, I would say a lot of the time, there's tons of videos online of people complaining about their heritage online, which I want to help fix so that people can understand each other more. So I think it was pretty much across the board. Especially with Indonesian, because one, nobody knows where Indonesia is, and they've never heard it before, so they automatically see my face and think I'm Chinese, which ethnically I am. I'm the sixth generation outside of China, but as a kid being raised in a household that speaks Indonesian, you don't want to be labeled as such. And so we're in this car ride, and it was really boring. It's only 2 hours, but as a 10-year-old, it's, you know, are we there yet? Are we there yet? And then the whole car ride, they were just cracking jokes, all the adults in Indonesian, and I was very frustrated because I didn't understand anything. But I knew it was funny, just didn't understand. And my dad tried to translate, but every time he translated one, there was two, three more, so we just kind of gave up after a while. But then I resolved, you know what? I want to laugh. I want to be part of the conversation, and I want to enjoy it. This, you know, this is family. This is what life's about, laughing. And so that's how I started, basically.
Okay, so your parents spoke to you in English?
Yeah.
Okay. How do you feel about that?
They wanted to make sure that I knew that I was American. So this is funny, but most immigrant parents will tell their kids they are from X country rather than where they're born or where they grow up. And it actually produces a reverse effect. So the odd thing is, with me and my sister, we both speak Indonesian now, while other people that were told they were Indonesian from birth don't.
Okay. This is a great, we could really go off on a tangent, but we're not going to, because we're going to stick to the topic today. But let's definitely come back to that another time. Mm-hmm. So a few rapid fire questions then. You started learning your first foreign language when you were how old?
So I got inspired at 10 at that car ride, but I finally started when I was about 13-ish, I think, when I went to Indonesia for the first time in a while.
When did you start playing the guitar?
That's a rough question. I started with forced lessons at the age of 5, and but they were about 5 minutes, you know, every 2 or 3 days, because I just absolutely refused to. My dad tried everything he could, but I was a rebellious child. So that's a rough estimate.
How many languages do you speak now?
depends on who you're talking to. I would say a basis of 5 that I can totally converse in and be fluent in. I do speak a little bit of Dutch and Portuguese, and I'm working on Italian using Benny Lewis's book, which I think is great.
Okay, yeah. And so the 5 languages that you're comfortable in are English, obviously, Indonesian,
French, German, and Spanish.
Okay, cool. A lot of similarities with my story there, actually, apart from the mixed heritage thing. I'm kind of white British, like, through and through.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Well, it's a bit boring, but yeah, it is what it is, right?
Right.
And so the in terms of music, so my main instrument is piano, and I started playing piano when I was 6, and I had lessons pretty much every week for my whole childhood. Wanted to give up many times, went through periods of hating it. My mum forced me to continue. Very glad you did. I was learning classical piano, right? But then when I was 16, I discovered jazz.
Right.
And I kind of went crazy about jazz, and then ended up going to music college. I went to a conservatoire in London to study jazz piano.
Which one?
The Guildhall School of Music.
Okay. Yeah.
And drama.
Well known. Well known.
Yeah. So I did a jazz piano degree there for 4 years, and then went off and played professionally for quite a few years after that, and then the music gradually died away for me as I discovered various things. We'll get into that later. So now are you still studying, or do you play professionally? Or
So I'm doing my master's right now, but it's kind of a rough spot because I'm trying to build a blog currently, and because I just kind of, I mean, if my friends heard me say this, they'd probably shoot me, but I feel that classical music in and of itself is very limiting. It's a very niche audience, and it doesn't impact the world. And I forgot who said it. Oh, I think, what's his name? Makoto Fujimura, this Japanese painter based in the New York metro area. He said, you know, art is beautiful, but it's not necessary. And that's what makes it beautiful. And so as great as music is, I'm kind of leaving that, just like you did, to kind of inspire people and speak in a language they do speak, which is unfortunately not music.
Sure. I guess the major difference there in our two stories, because we both started playing music about the same time, both at our parents' behest. I think the guitar is a little bit different because the guitar physically is extremely challenging for young kids, whereas the piano is not. You just have to kind of press a key and you get a sound. But with the guitar, because I also play the guitar and I taught guitar for a while as well, the precision and the muscle strength you need in your fingers of both hands is really tough. And I think that you don't tend to start playing the guitar as a child until quite a bit later, right? It's a bit like singing. I mean, most professional guitarists I know, they started when they were kind of maybe 10. It wasn't that young compared to a lot of others. So the major difference with us then is that my language learning started when I was 19. I really didn't, because I grew up in an environment with no foreign languages at all, other than the odd kind of family trip to France, where we would all kind of massacre ordering the baguettes every morning. You know, I had no exposure to languages at all. So it all happened all of a sudden for me. And I had to kind of not only discover how to learn languages, but also why to learn languages. I guess you had a pretty solid reason, a pretty clear reason from an early age.
Yeah.
Didn't you? So, okay. So we're talking about music and languages, and it's interesting that you already feel that you're moving away from music and towards languages. I mean, that's certainly what happened to me as well, although it took a lot longer for me. I really wasn't sure what I was doing for a long time. I'd always been learning languages since I was 19, but it took me quite a long time to come to the realization that actually, you know, this musician's lifestyle is not really for me. But one of the things that I'm always very aware of when I'm learning languages and doing all kinds of things, actually, is my musical background. Like, I still remember very clearly what life as a student musician was like, and the amount of time that we would spend practicing, the amount of time spent performing and rehearsing the performance and all these things. I still have that memory is always there whenever I take on any kind of difficult task, such as learning a language. So maybe, like, by way of starting off this discussion then, let me ask you, how would your language learning have been different if you hadn't had any music in your life?
Okay. So for starters, I would say I'm a very non-disciplined person. And I'm always looking for the easiest way out of things, I think, in general. Even with Italian, right now, I'm just using Benny's book and maybe listening to a few podcasts and things. But I'm not putting as much effort as one should. And the thing is, with musicians, as you know, Olly, practicing 5 hours a day is actually not enough. You know, and people look at us and go, how do you do that? You know, but we say, no, it's just not enough. And that's when we learn all these techniques like chunking, which we can talk about now or later, that help us just effectively and efficiently use our time rather than just doing something from beginning to end, which I think many musicians do. And those tend to be ones that don't go far because they spend so much time playing their repertoire over and over. And same for language learners. They feel that as long as they've gone over a dialogue from beginning to end 20 times a day, it'll stick in their brain. But the truth is they have to play with it. They have to, you know, kind of shape how they practice, quote unquote.
Yeah, well, let's talk about that because, like, to my mind, this is one of the major connections between music and languages. And it's often, I think, when people ask this question, like, how has being a musician helped your language learning? I think most of the time what people have in their mind is, like, accent and and your ear. But actually, I mean, I'm sure that helps, but the one of the main things that I feel I've got from music is exactly what you just mentioned, which is the experience of practicing. So you talked about chunking, you talked about 5 hours a day, which for most people doing anything is a crazy amount of time, right?
Right.
Unless it's work. Right. So talk more about that, about the role of practice or what you learned from practice and chunking, as you put it, and how that relates to language learning.
Okay. So I've noticed a lot of people in the language learning community in general, when they hear the word music, they equate it to song. And that's something I think we both agree on is not actually what music is. And so what I try to do personally is to try and make people realize that it's about using musical techniques. Learn from the musicians themselves, not what they produce.
Why do you say music isn't song? Or song isn't music?
It is, but...
Because I know what you're getting at here. You're getting at, but I'd like you to expand on that.
Right. It's not limited to songs. So when people think of music, they can name songs off the top of their head. But music is a culture. Music is a time and space, like... 200 years ago, whatever it may be, a person from Germany, let's say Bach, you know, walking around. It's more than just, let's say, Rihanna's new hit or something like that, which I don't know what it is. But, you know, because when musicians talk about music, we will ask further what composers you play, which era is your favorite? Do you like Renaissance? Do you like classical? Do you like romantic? But for most people, music is as of the past 3 years. Anything beyond that is old.
So you're talking about the role of music in popular culture, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. So, okay. Going back to what you were saying before.
No problem. So what I advocate is something I call stealing from musicians in the sense, just what art really is not looking only at what your profession has, but what everyone else has as well. And so that's my encouragement to language learners is that they would look at the way we practice, which we can equate to study, look at the way we have technique, which we can equate somewhat to accent reduction, music theory, knowledge can be grammar, ear training can be vocabulary, and those are interchangeable. You want me to go on from there or?
Yeah, well, there's a lot of stuff there. I mean, so you mentioned the amount of practice that you do in a day and how you'd use techniques like chunking to actually make that effective. So
right.
What's the connection there with language learning?
Okay. So let's take out the guitar for a second. And let's say you have a passage. So I think number one thing is when people try to learn a language, they go, oh my God, I have to learn French. Benny talks about this all the time. Don't think I have to learn X language. Think about today I want to order a cup of coffee, or tomorrow I want to go to the grocery store. And so when we break things down, it becomes doable rather than a pain in the butt and fear, like something we fear. So for instance, if I was to take this passage on a guitar, it's an etude by Villa-Lobos, Brazilian composer. Just that first bar. It sounds really complicated. It's really fast. But when somebody hears that, they go, oh my God, that's how I have to play. Oh no, I'm never going to do this. So if you go around looking at French people and seeing the way they speak and comparing yourself to them. So the recommendation is there's three things you can do that I highly recommend. One is different tempo, two, different rhythm, and three, repeating notes. And we know this as musicians. We don't do things from A to Z or Z over and over.
Can you explain the difference between tempo and rhythm?
Yeah, so tempo, we would say, is the speed at which you're playing at. So for instance, if you want to play, the original tempo for this is, but you could play it as, just to slow it down so that you can digest what you're doing as you are playing rather than mindlessly practicing. So rhythm, what I would say is what jazz musicians do amazingly is they swing. So for instance, if I was to practice this, I would go. The whole goal of this whole thing is brain flexibility. That's because when we are able to be flexible, we can fix our mistakes as we're speaking because we're conscious of them. For different tempo, you can use a metronome as well. And experiment between going slower, beyond normal speaking speed and faster, and then you adjust in between. I'm sure you've done that as well.
So we've got tempo, rhythm, and what was the third one?
Repeating notes.
Repeating the notes, okay, as a practice technique, you mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Can you give us a quick example of that?
Yeah, so instead of, again, you'll go. So if I were to do it in English, let's do it in English, in a language everyone understands, is a different tempo would be saying, hello, my name is Olly Richards. So speak whale. Think of Nemo. Speak whale. A rhythm, you could say, hi, my name is Olly Richards. Put a beat on it and then you just go on from there. Or you can go opposite. Instead of going, hi, my name is, you can go, hi, my name is Olly Richards. And so the more we drill these different rhythms, our mouths will be looser and then we can speak flawlessly, more or less.
And so I think that the tempo thing is kind of evident enough. Right, mm-hmm. Because if you do something slowly, then it's easier to follow what's going on. Right. The point about rhythm is an interesting one, because as I understand it, and as I used to practice as well, music that is, when you put stuff in a different rhythm, when you play around with it. And tell me if I'm following you here or not. But mm-hmm. as I understand it, by playing around with rhythm and actually practicing things in a way that aren't correct, but you're just experimenting with a different rhythm, mm-hmm. what you're doing is you're kind of creating a bit of flexibility for yourself. You're teaching yourself to manipulate the passage of music that you're actually practicing, which makes you more confident with it at the end.
Exactly.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, because when, as we know, when we meet our first person to have our conversation with in X language, target language, we freak out, we get unsettled, we get nervous beforehand, and the same thing happens when you go on stage. We have stage fright. And so when you practice things differently, what you're doing is practicing essentially mistakes that could potentially happen on stage, that your brain will have already rehearsed, and thus you can go back and spring to how you're supposed to play.
Right. And yeah. This is, I guess, exactly what Rachmaninoff was getting at when he said that in order to truly know a piece for the piano, you have to be able to play the right hand part with the left hand and the left hand part with the right hand equally well. Or, I mean, I don't know, equally well, but you have to be able to do it, because right. only then are you fully in control of the or fully aware and inside the music that you're trying to play. Not that you would ever play the left-hand part with the right hand, but it's the fact of learning to do that that takes you from a point of only kind of having a surface level knowledge of something to the point where you know it so deeply that, you know, you could be in the middle of playing of a performance on a piano in a concert hall in front of 2,000 people. You could have like a cat jump up on the piano, run past you, and then like totally distract you, but you know it so intricately that however badly your concentration is shot, you are always going to be okay and you're always going to be able to get back and continue because you just have that in that deep intrinsic understanding of what you're playing from
exactly
from a harmonic perspective, from a rhythmic perspective, from a structural perspective. Like in a song, for example, learning the lyrics to a song, knowing one of the hardest things in learning a song is actually remembering which bit comes next. Sounds obvious, right? But actually,
right.
When you it's the second that you stop concentrating is when you're at risk because you know you could have verses with different variations and you have to keep track of what comes next, right? So again, just to continue giving examples, one of the things that I often do when I'm learning songs or learning speeches or monologues or something like that is I often practice it backwards. So if you've got like something with 8 lines in it, once I think I know the piece or the speech or whatever the right way from consecutively from beginning to end, I'll start at the end and work backwards. So I'll say line 8 and then I'll say line 7 and I'll say line 6 because you are coming at it from all these different angles, which forces your brain to think, to stop thinking linearly and to look at it from lots of different angles so that you kind of have this this overall complete holistic understanding of what you're playing, and it's not just muscle memory, which is another a big risk for musicians, right? You kind of you practiced a piece 200 times, you think you know it, but actually it's just the muscles that remember where to go. If you get distracted or you have a momentary lapse in concentration, and your muscles lose their place, you risk not being able to get back there if you're relying on the muscles alone and you don't have the kind of mental understanding of what you're doing.
Yeah.
So I've just said a whole bunch of stuff. So do you want to react to what I've just said?
I think you hit the nail on the head. For more encouragement for people, language learners, there are people, you know, professionals, like let's say Pablo Casals. I know he had a huge, the cellist, he had a huge problem with stage fright, huge problem. And he is one of the world's most famous cellists in history, but every time he would just freak out. And even him, and he's performed pieces multiple times, made tons of recordings, everyone knows who he is. So stage fright is normal, I think, but it's definitely something we can get over as well with time. But the main problem is a muscle memory. Yeah.
This is a really nice segue into another area that I think training as a musician gives you a huge advantage in language learning, which is the experience of performance, right? And, you know, I remember the experience so many times of going out on stage and having to perform something to people. And you learn to kind of detach yourself a bit, don't you? And you kind of put the music in the foreground. You let the music do the speaking and you kind of slink off into the background almost and just play that thing and let the music be the object of everybody's attention. And to my mind, it's very similar with language learning. You know, when you approach someone, you start speaking to someone, I find that if I practice and I'm good at the language and what I'm about to say, then I find that I can kind of introduce myself in this other language, and let the language do the talking, as it were, so that I don't feel necessarily too embarrassed or too self-conscious being in that position, trying to speak this other language. Because I think because of the training of playing music in public. So have you noticed anything similar in that respect?
Oh yeah. There's something what I call the various stages of filtration in order to help us get over our stage fright, because each time, so if we were, a stage one is basically us in our room. if we're learning a language, we're alone. We're with our textbook. That's great. And if we go to another stage, then it could be you with your teacher, who you're supposed to make mistakes in front of, right? And you meet them every week, let's say, if you're a musician or doing italki or something, sponsor of the show. the next stage would be maybe to talk to a friend of yours. That might be a bit uncomfortable, but at least it's somebody familiar. Then your next stage after that would be going out in public and just going to your local Mexican restaurant if you're learning Spanish. And then the last one would be going to the country, the target country. And each time, you need to build a certain amount of confidence. And then as you graduate these levels, when you get to the next one, again, you need to build enough confidence to move on to the next one and the next one. For me, there was this one point in my third year of college, my junior year, where somehow, I didn't do this on purpose, but I managed to book myself performances for all of April and most of May. And playing two or three times a week actually took it away. So it was tons and tons of practice in front of people, to the point where it's as simple as brushing your teeth, I think, is the main thing that we need to realize, is we just need to make it natural and forget and say that it's a part of us rather than something we're learning how to do.
You're talking about the practicing or the performance?
Both. Yeah. Well, I guess mainly performance, because a lot of people complain about stage fright, which is normal. But I've always been taught that as you do it more, it will go away. But it does. It's always somewhat there, lingering.
Yeah. I mean, I don't. I think it's always there, isn't it? I mean,
yeah.
So, I mean, I've given a lot of talks before at conferences and events, mm-hmm. and things like that, and I will always get nervous before I get up and give a talk.
Always. Oh no, that's for
like,
sure.
No matter how well prepared I am, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. The only difference is I kind of learned to embrace it, I think. And yeah. I learned to kind of feed off the nervousness and use that to create some buzz. And I think the same is true with music. I mean, I guess the thing that I'm thinking at this point is that, here's the thing. If we take classical music as a comparison, with mm-hmm. classical music, you might take the Villa-Lobos piece, for example, that you just mm-hmm. played before. How many hours would you say in total you spent practicing that piece? Ballpark.
Oh man, I have no idea.
But we're talking hundreds, right?
Yeah, at least
many hundreds, if not thousands, of hours practicing that piece, because it's a beast, that one. I think I tried to play that, but I was never good enough to play that on the guitar. So here's the difference: like in this case, you're spending all this time practicing this one piece. Mm-hmm. It's the same notes over and over again. The notes don't change, never.
Right.
But with language learning, it's not the same animal, right? Because the words do change, the grammar does mm-hmm. change, the stuff that you say does change. So in the sense that when we come to speak a language with people, you never know what's going to happen. How mm-hmm. can you, how do you reconcile the difference between learning one piece of music and then learning to prepare for the unknown, which is what speaking a language always is?
In that case, I think speaking languages is a lot more like jazz. I think that's something you're more qualified to talk about than I am, because I just play whatever's on the page and I add my emotions to it.
It is a huge difference, isn't it? Like classical music and jazz are very, very different. They mm-hmm. really are. Like, I mean, so for those people who maybe aren't so familiar with it, I mean, there are various different kinds of jazz, right? And just as there is classical music with mm-hmm. jazz or improvised elements mm-hmm. as a part of it, there's a broad spectrum. But in general, when we talk about jazz, we're talking about perhaps a tune or a melody mm-hmm. that is performed, which tends to be quite brief, but then you have a much longer, more extensive improvised section where you take the harmonic progression of the piece that you've just, the tune that you've just played, and then you mm-hmm. improvise on it, and that goes round and round and round, and you just play and you make stuff up, and the kind of the focus, the feature of the jazz performance is that improvisation. And most jazz musicians, excuse me, are assessed or graded on their ability to improvise. Mm-hmm. So you think, you know, well, who is the greatest jazz musician in the world? You know, if you're asking that question in the 90s or the 2000s, you might say the name Keith Jarrett would come up a lot mm-hmm. because he is generally regarded, perhaps not anymore, but for a long time, as the world's best improviser. Not the world's best learner of pieces or learner of tunes to perform, but the world's best person at taking a quarter and improvising. So with jazz, we are practicing the fundamentals. We're learning how to improvise melodically, rhythmically, harmonically over a particular chord sequence. We're learning the rules, if you like, and when to break them, which is just as important in jazz. But then when we actually come to perform, all bets are off. It's up to you, right? It's like you have to you improvise, you make it up. But that making it up is informed by the rules and the things that you know how to do. So in that respect, it's very related to language learning and very related to speaking. So in terms of practice, like when I practice jazz, I'm not doing what you're doing with that Villa-Lobos piece. Because with that Villa-Lobos piece, you're practicing the same notes over and over again and learning to perform them in the most exquisite way. Mm-hmm. With the jazz, it's not like that. The practice is learning how the best way through the chord sequence in a particular piece. So how to improvise over that chord sequence in such a way that you manage tension and release, you resolve harmonic changes in the right way, all while creating a nice melody through the improvisation. And I guess maybe that's what I mean when I say I get used to my memory and experience of performance of jazz helps me with speaking languages, because I see a lot of parallels there. You never know exactly what's going to happen when you're playing jazz. You're dependent on the bassist and the drummer, just as if in a conversation you're dependent on the person you're speaking to. But still, there is an element in the jazz of repetition. You're learning a 16-bar chord sequence or a 32-bar progression. It's very different from learning an entire language and how to deploy it and use it.
Right.
I guess with the language, I've got all these gut feelings and these hunches, but it's very difficult to say exactly. But I think the one thing is that, you know, I always spend a lot of time practicing functional language when I'm speaking, you know. So ways to introduce ideas, ways to react to what someone said. You could call them like milestone parts of a conversation, things that have to happen. And so I guess that's very similar to the jazz practice. I don't know. I don't want to overdraw the parallel here, if you know what I mean. But I think there is a huge amount of stuff to compare, if only in the respect that you have to be comfortable with the uncertainty of not knowing exactly what's going to happen, right?
Yeah, no, I think the thing is, this is probably one of the first times that I can think of that people are actually discussing this from two musical backgrounds. So there's a lot of things we can attack. So I totally understand. We're thinking out loud as well right now.
Yeah, well, exactly. I mean, there's one thing we haven't touched on in this conversation, which is the role of accent and pronunciation.
Mm-hmm.
Because as I said before, this is what most people go, this is their kind of go-to thing when they talk about, well, what's the link between music and languages. Most people think, oh, you have a good pronunciation or good accent in your languages because you're a musician.
Mm-hmm.
People say to me all the time, like, you're able to produce the tones in Cantonese or Thai because you've got a good ear.
Right.
I don't know, because I don't know what it's like not to be a musician.
Mm.
So it's kind of difficult for me to know. I think it's fair to say that, like, I do have a good ear, and that comes from the music for sure. And I tend to feel like in general my pronunciation and my accents, my production of languages is pretty good, and I'm sure there is a connection. But maybe you could talk about that for a minute in your experience.
Yeah. So I think I was approached by a lady that was trying to become a teacher in my high school. She just came up to me. She said, "Are you a musician?" I said, "Yeah. Why?" "Because your French is so good." I said, and that was when I realized there was a connection. It never fazed me. So when we talk about our ears and being able to hear, what that means is we can hear the difference between, for instance, a T. A T in different languages is not the same thing. there's a da, there's a da, there's a da, there's a ts. Yeah, and these are all ts written as ts. And the job that we have as language learners is to be able to hear the difference. And so, you know, when we make fun of Americans for speaking other languages, which I think is the worst accent ever, yo quiero comer, you know, it's very, you
stop,
know,
please.
Ollie's shaking his head now. But the reason is, it's not because they suck, but
it's not just Americans, by the way. English sounds pretty much exactly the same.
Yeah, I think it's the English in general. The language just gives us all these sounds. And so if we take yo quiero comer, the problem is we're not able to hear that the sounds are shorter. Yo quiero comer. And it's the rhythms are different. For instance, if I take Indonesian, if I was going to say, halo nama saya Fiel. So I just introduced myself. My name is Fiel. Halo nama saya. It's very it's very short. Everything's very staccato and it's very sharp. Now, English is not like that. We're very round. We're very just kind of wavy. So that's the main thing, is being able to hear the different A's in each language, and that each language has a different mouth set. Just like a classical guitar is not a flamenco guitar, it's not a jazz guitar, I think. Yeah.
You know, when I think about the areas of listening and pronunciation that I think might be helped by the musical background, that, you know, the example that you gave is one of the areas that I don't immediately think of, actually, because I've noticed that one kind of pet peeve of mine in language learning, one thing that I often fail to understand, is the difference, for example, between short and long vowels. Mm. So I have this in Cantonese sometimes, where you have, you have a big difference between saying leng and leng in Cantonese. But if I'm just listening, I often won't hear that, because especially when people speak quickly, that difference between the short and long vowel reduces to the point where it's almost indistinguishable. So that's something that I struggle with quite a lot. And there's other, I mean, just to keep taking the Cantonese example, because that's what I'm working on at the moment, there are lots of slightly different consonant sounds which don't really exist in English. And you have a kind of different spectrum of consonant sounds which are quite hard. And I find it a little bit difficult to hear those. So I don't know the extent to which, like, having a musical ear helps you across all ranges of pronunciation, but the thing that the area which I do feel fairly confident in is that of the sentence level stuff, like sentential things such as intonation or sentence stress or things like that. So I feel very attuned to the melody of a language, like in the kind of the typical Brazilian Portuguese song like intonation, or the sort of tight, constrained Spanish, very limited range of pitch, the kind of slow, cautious, methodical, panther-like Japanese way of expressing ideas in a sentence, or the kind of Cantonese tones which just take you melodically all over the spectrum. Like, I pick up on those really quickly, and just the same way as if you, like, when you introduce yourself, like I just said then, like, when you introduce yourself, you've got a very clear contour to that sentence. Introduce yourself. You've got not only a rising, falling pattern, introduce yourself, but you've also got a stressed word there, which is introduce. And then it's one of the syllables within that word, juice, introduce yourself. Like, that anyone who's looking to improve their English pronunciation is going to listen to that phrase, introduce yourself, and try to get that right. I feel like I'm pretty good at picking up on the shape and the form of those kind of sentences in other languages. So I kind of feel like it's, for me, it's more of a macro scale than a micro scale. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I mean, I agree with you. When you were talking about introduce yourself, other examples, English does this a lot. And I can only think of two examples, but one word can have two meanings depending on the stress of it. Here's your present. Do you want to present or here's my address in American English. And then, so today he's going to give an address. It's totally different things.
You sure? Word stress. Yeah. Desert. Dessert.
Yeah, word stress. Mm-hmm. Right, right. Yeah.
And that, so that's something that, that you feel, that you find is, I mean, different languages are different, right? Because English is a, English is a stress-timed language, right? So you need to get that stress right in order to get the, to speak properly. Whereas something like Spanish is a syllable-timed language. You don't have that kind of, you don't have that same necessity. But still, you've got, I mean, like I said, every language has those words where you have that word stress and you need to get it right. That's something that comes naturally to you or you struggle with or what?
Yeah. I think in the beginning, everyone struggles with it, but I've also found that, you know, after having learned a few languages, you get better at it because you can compare it to your native language. But I've also been surrounded by, the Indonesian community. You know, in Indonesia, we have 300 different ethnic groups and 700 different languages. So there are people from all over all the time. And my dad, he speaks a few other languages and he's picked up on those and he'll speak in those to those people from there. So I could hear different accents. And so I was born in Portland, Oregon. And then I moved to New York when I was 10. And hearing people talk like this, you know, it was like, oh my God, that's disgusting. But do I want to have this accent? No. So I chose not to. But, you know, it's there. And so it's just hearing that compared to your real accent, you kind of have a dictionary of sounds in your head that you can pull out at a different time.
You know, I wonder if people who grow up with multiple languages have a kind of training that's similar to that of a musician.
Mm-hmm.
So someone who grows up speaking, say, English and Chinese bilingually, or like someone who, you know, typical situation here in the UK, say a child has a Polish mother, a Spanish father, and goes to an English-speaking school. So they grow up mm-hmm. with exposure to three languages. I wonder whether that sensitivity gives you the kind of, whether that exposure gives you the kind of sensitivity that you get from studying music. I guess it must be fairly similar because you just have to get used to distinguishing things, right?
Mm-hmm.
I guess another way of approaching that question would be, what is it exactly about the musical training that gives you this sensitivity in your ear to pick up on different things? What is it exactly? Mm-hmm. What element of your musical background do you think gives you that sensitivity?
So I actually would say my musical background doesn't give enough because the guitar, for those of you that are watching the video, it has frets, right? And each fret makes sure that the note stays in tune. Now, if you play a violin, one of the other stringed instruments, violin, viola, or cello, you have to be able to know exactly where to place your finger on your instrument. If not, it'll be out of tune. And so it's that forced, quote unquote, desire to sound good, but also to know what is actually right that causes us to strive for it, because our teachers are also on our case and there's a whole bunch of people looking around as well. Side note is that it's interesting, but people specifically from Asian countries like Korea and China, mainly China, tend to have perfect pitch across the board. For those of you that don't know, perfect pitch is when you're able to just hear a note or even a sound and tell someone what the note is.
Is that true that they tend to have perfect pitch? Really?
But they also have much more musical training from an earlier age over there.
But
at least that's what I've noticed in conservatory.
But what's the perfect pitch attributed to? Is it
tonal lines?
Yeah,
some do say it's the tones, but I would also back it up with a lot of ear training from when they're young that we in the States just simply do not have. You kind of learn all this music theory and solfege once you get to conservatoire,
Really? Okay, that's a big difference, because in Europe, I mean, the ear training is pushed right from the beginning in lots of kind of mainstream music teaching.
Right. I mean, also, I think the other thing is we don't really go to our local conservatory or a conservatoire. Most people go to a local teacher. Sometimes you have music schools around, but usually a lot of it is very YouTube-based now. And it tends to be the ones that can afford it that go to straight to the music schools.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah. Okay, listen, well, we could go on for weeks, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But one thing I want to touch on before we finish is the implication of all of this. Because, you know, what do we have to say to somebody who has no music, someone listening to this or watching this now, who has no musical background and is learning their first foreign language?
Mm-hmm.
Because I could understand how someone in that position might be feeling, well, I don't have a hope. You know, I have no music, I have no language background. What am I supposed to do?
Right.
So I've got my own thoughts about that, but what's your reaction to that problem?
You know, I think it's easy to forget why we do something in the first place. And especially if you go to a language event, whether it be Langfest, the gathering, or the conference, you meet all these people with all these badges and, you know, they got all these languages on there with these stickers and you get intimidated as well. But the whole point is to communicate with people. The reason you learn a language is to love out loud through conversation. And what I mean by that is just listening to people, getting to understand people from different points of view. You know, maybe in the States, you just cannot stand Trump supporters. Take the time to talk to them, you know, and or maybe you just kind of have a prejudice towards Hispanics because you just hear all this stuff on the news. Go to one of their restaurants, you know, and talk with them. Say, hey, how did you get here? Let me understand a bit more of your culture. I think that for me is the main point, is to enjoy people.
But are we saying that the accent, yeah. Are we saying that the your ear and the accent and stuff doesn't matter? Because I think it does.
It does, but it's not most important, I'd say.
I mean, I guess when I, you know, looking back on the various years that I've spent with music and languages, I mean, all of this stuff is learnt. None of us are born with this. Like, we get at it through hard work. And a lot of the, you know, a lot of the gains, I think, you get fairly early on. So with just with a small amount of music practice or musical training or a small amount of dedication and devotion to languages by, you know, taking the time to learn a language, just with that, I think a lot of the gains come quickly. It's not the case that you have to do this for 20 years in order to experience these gains. I mean, it is all of these things can be and are learnt through deliberate practice and repetition and learning and focus.
Right.
And I think the worst thing of all is for people to kind of think, well, you know, I don't have this natural talent or I don't have this background, therefore I cannot X.
That's a whole other podcast.
It is. But I just wanted to kind of plant that there because it's kind of easy. I don't know. I'm just conscious that most people don't have the extensive musical training that we do, but I would hate for it to come across as a requirement to be a polyglot or to learn languages.
Yeah,
or
whatever. Not at all.
Yeah. Okay. Well, listen. I think we'll draw that to a close then. But this has been absolutely fascinating. It's great to see. You know, we've got a lot of similar experiences and ideas, I think, but it's really refreshing to hear these ideas spoken about from someone that's not me. So, you know, thank you for that. That's been really great. Where can people go and where can people connect with you if they want to learn more about you or look you up?
Okay, so people can find me on betweenthreeworlds.com, where I discuss loving out loud, having better conversations with people. I talk about music and languages a little bit, not too much. I focus more on just getting at the hearts of people and more humanitarian things. But also, if you guys are interested, Olly will put this in the show notes. We talked about chunking and we talked a bit about stage fright. So I've written an article on Shannon Kennedy's blog, Eurolinguist, and specifically on chunking and how to practice your language like a musician learns his music. And there's also a post, which is not yet posted, but will be, on Lingualift's blog on stage fright and how to conquer it.
Great. We'll put a link to those in the show notes. Fantastic. And maybe I can persuade you to write something like that for my blog as well.
Sure. I'd be more than happy to. Also, I almost forgot. I did do a talk on this at the Polyglot Gathering. Olly will also put that in the show notes. And it kind of gives a big philosophical run through. I know it's a lot of information, but the main point is to get food for thought in your minds and then just grow what sticks out to you most.
Absolutely. Phil, it's great to talk to you, man. All the best, and enjoy the rest of the day and the rest of the spring and the summer and the rest of the year in New York.
Thank you so much, Olly. It's a pleasure. Look forward to hearing from everyone.
Talk to you soon.